Welcome to Insight Builder channel. Big data leaders, data learners, and my dear friends. Exploring the power of single node cluster using Spark DBL commands. We are going to unlock the power of the Hadoop cluster that we have built. Before we dive into Spark and start creating databases and tables, in this video, I would like to introduce about the overview of the Spark commands as well as the table creation commands. And also we'll create some of the databases, also look at the data set that we'll be using, and then later in the next video we will actually dive deep into the table creation processes. Hive and Spark have a very similar kind of data types. The Hive data types, almost all of it works well with Spark also. And in fact, the Spark metastore and Hive metastore are same, they are not different. And most of the times, the file formats that we are going to use also matches exactly with how we are going to work with Hive. So that is what I have shown in this slide. Second, to start this Spark session, you can use couple of ways. You can use PySpark. When you are using PySpark, you can directly use PySpark with master as yarn and the Spark warehouse Spark warehouse directory that I have shown here. If you are using Jupyter Notebook, then you can use this particular syntax to create the Spark session, and from the Spark session you can create the Spark SQL. Both of the ways are okay. What you need to understand here is that the way you create this particular configuration, this will decide where the warehouse, this warehouse directory will be located. If you are going to initiate it using the Spark SQL or Spark session itself, then this warehouse directory will be inside the HDFS environment. Okay, ensure that you do it that way, or else you will end up getting the Spark warehouse outside in the Linux environment. It will not be a big data environment, it will be a regular data environment. I mean local file system, right? We'll see that in action. Next, when it comes to databases, we use a regular create database method, and we create the database, the tables in database inside the Spark SQL, and we can select the current database, whichever is the current database, it will get selected, and we can use the table names. So I am showing the various table name discussion here to describe the table names and to use extended and formatted keywords. We will be seeing all these things in action. The describe table name is very, very important when it comes to big data, because the table, the way the schema has been created, it also comes along with the metadata. So when you are using extended or formatted describe option, what will happen is you will get the location of the file also from which the table is created. So actually all the tables inside the Spark or Hive database is actually a pointer. It's kind of a pointer inside the environment to the file location. That is all. All the activity on the file and the intermediate process is done by the Spark engine or the Hive engine based on the connection only, based on that simple pointer. Okay, so it's a very powerful way of working. In order to create a table, the process is very simple. Okay, the create table process is same as how you create table in other databases like MySQL and Postgres or whichever database you are using. When it comes to storing the data, we can actually control. So in case of Postgres or MySQL or Oracle, you don't control where the file is going to be stored. In case of HDFS, that is Hadoop and Spark environment, you can actually control the way the table is getting stored. Okay, so you will see this in action. So this is the particular command which says, okay, what is the type of the file in which the table is going to get stored, and this actually has a huge impact on the file size also. And there are various file types like text file, ORC, Parquet, etc. You can give these things here, and the format, the row format also you can give below. Once you create the table, this will be part of the create table. Okay, this will be part of create table. I will show it in a moment, but I wanted to show it separately. And this will be part of loading the data. and this data is getting loaded from the HDFS file system. So keep that in mind. This into table will append the data, and overwrite into table will overwrite the data. So simply by changing the keyword, the actual action will change. All these things I am, you know, rapidly introducing. Don't worry about that. We'll be going in detail each of this step by step. The reason why I am rapidly introducing is that I want to cover as much ground as possible and then show you the real action. Here we see that we can create external table, and this is the managed table. In case of managed table, we don't have the location. You see this here, right? We don't have the location here. So this will become a managed table. The data will be inside the HDFS Spark environment only. In case of create external, when I say external and I give the location here, this will entirely be taken care as an external data table only. So what is the difference? When we specify external, the other data players like Hive or Pig or Scoop or even any other DBT could actually connect with that file and it can work on it. Okay, it is no longer restricted. But in case of managed, it's not the case. You cannot connect directly. You cannot read it also. Because of the serial, there is some kind of a serialization, deserialization happens. So you cannot read that file. And also second thing, when you are going to drop the external table, only the metadata will get dropped inside the Spark environment, but not the table at all. So keep that also in the mind. When it comes to the table creation, we can actually provide the data source also. So we can, as we saw, we can give the data source of CSV, text, ORC, all these files, and we can give the JDBC location also. That is the databases, other databases also. But when we are going to store it, we can actually use different row formats. So this row format is basically, it's kind of a keyword to tell Hive and Spark to convert the file or to compress the file into a different format. And for that, there are various serializer, deserializers, that is service in the cloud cluster. In the cluster discussion, we always say servdes only. So we don't say serializer, deserializer, we say servdes. And you can read everything about it in this particular link. It has a very detailed explanation, and it's well written also. We have all this servdes coming along with the installation, so we can use it out of the box. But as of now, this is advanced, we are not going to touch it. We'll be working on basics of getting up and running with the Spark cluster. Basic DDL. Okay, now you might be wondering, I have been speaking about DDL, but you did not find any DDL commands. Okay, DDL is basically short form for data definition language. So here we are actually defining the table. So we are defining the table as well as how the data inside the table should be there. So we are defining the integer, we are defining the string, etc., right? So we are basically doing that. So that is why it is called as data definition language. Just in case, I'm sure that you might have already heard of this, but I just want to reiterate for people who are new to this databases as well as the cluster environment. Finally, the point of the next step, I will be showing the data set, I will be showing the cluster also, and I will be starting working on the cluster command line. The request to you guys is also, you also follow the same thing. You get the data set and inside your cluster start practicing. The reason why we are giving the data set and directly showing you using the command prompt is that you can also in parallel work along with us, along with the video, and learn. Most of the time the activities will sync, and if there is any place where the output that you get and where the output I get is different, then we can actually discuss over the comments, or you can discuss with your friends and team members to understand how to resolve the challenges. It will be a very easy way to learn about big data terminologies as well as big data commands, especially with Spark. Spark is very, very important, and it has lots of benefits. You will be seeing that in a couple of videos down the line. I hope that you like this content. Do share it with others and subscribe to my content, so that in the future videos, like the next videos, I'll be working on tables and then on PySpark related topics. So do subscribe. You will be getting immediate updates once I upload the videos. With that said, let us go to the browser now. If you are new to the environment of big data and you want to build your own cluster, etc., you can actually take a look at this playlist. Also, you can take a look at this playlist for getting up to speed on working with the dataset, Kaggle dataset, and also trying to work with Hadoop commands. So I extensively deal with Hadoop commands in this in these two videos. So take a look at that. Next is the dataset. I'll be using Kaggle environment dataset, the shop customer data. And this particular data, you can get access to it by using the API command, copy API command here, and you can download the data without much of an issue. You need to set up Kaggle, Kaggle API inside your environment. I show that in this particular video. Take a look at that. Once you, the reason why I'm using this data is that it is actually a very small data set. First of all, it's just 2000 records and has only 8 columns. You can manage it very easily inside the new environment. You are going to work on a very big data set, I agree, but when you are going to learn, it is better to learn on a data set which is sufficiently complex but not really complicated. That is, there is a difference between complex and complicated. Complex is that you have to learn a lot, you have to do a lot of changes inside the data set, but it's not linked with multiple things. So if there is going to be 100 columns, then if you have to manage everything, then you have to work on other applications. Like, you have to use a Jupyter notebook and you have to start pulling, you have to work on the columns in that environment, and then you have to do some changes and then push to a Spark database. So it involves complications, but we are still working in a simple command line environment, and we will be using this data set. That is the reason why I am using this. So take a look at this. I will be sharing the data set link also. And next, let us move to the AWS cloud environment. I have already got the instance up and running in my case, and I have the SSH available with me. I have to just copy this, and if I go to the terminal, and I can start working on the cluster directly. So usually, once you connect to the cluster, first and foremost, you need to check whether the cluster is running. So for that, we need to use JPS command. So this is the JPS command which tells whether the cluster is running or not. In my case, the cluster is running fully. Also, I have the script here which actually starts and stops the cluster. So if I do a cat start.cluster, you see that it actually starts all this applications, and if I do cat stop dot cluster, you will see that it stops all this. And most of the thing is that, most important thing is, I will stop the yarn first and then the DFS, and in case of starting, I will start DFS and then yarn. So this application process has to be maintained. Okay, so I just want to give you a brief. Next, what I'm going to do is, I'm going to import the dataset. So I have to just use this command, Kaggle dataset download D, and this dataset name I need to provide. I did not type it, I just copied it from the Kaggle dataset page and I pasted it here. So once I paste it, the dataset will get downloaded. In my case, it is already downloaded. You can see that the customers-dataset.zip is already available. So what I'm going to do is, I'm going to unzip it. Going to do an unzip, and then I'm going to give a name of it, so it will unzip it. I will say I just want to replace, there was already one customer CSV, so I'm going to just replace it. And if I do an ls right now, you'll see that there is a folder file called as customers.csv. Let us do a cat command on customers. I'm going in detail to a level of the dataset, because once you understand how to work with external data, that will be much more beneficial for you to, you'll be more confident. That is the main intention of, going with the external data. Let us start doing a cat, and let us do a first 5 row. Let us just see the first 5 rows, and you immediately see that the data set is, okay, it's very manageable, but the column names are having lots of gaps. So we need to correct that first. So we can use Vim Editor. if you are new to Wind Editor, if you have not used it, I would suggest that take a just a moment, take a look at my the discussion that I had on exploring top challenges in Linux. In this playlist, I discuss about getting up to speed with Vim also. So how to master Vim and how to using SpaceVim. So take a look at this series. You will get up to speed with Linux technology faster also. So let me go back to the terminal again. And let me start editing the, let us start editing the, okay, I don't want any gap, so I'm going to remove this, and wherever there is a gap, I'm just going to, okay, that was a delete, I do not want that. So wherever there is a gap, I'm going to just fill it. Okay, so you can do it in multiple ways. So you can actually use a underscore also. Those things actually matter least. Actually, it's not that much of a hassle, but ensure that you don't have any gap. That is very important. And just a minute, let me complete that. Okay, so I completed. I'm using WQ and saving it. And now if I do a cat command again and do a head, you see that my file has been modified. So it's a very simple editing that we did. It's a small file, right? Next, what we are going to do is we are going to do the HDFS command. So I'm going to do some removal of the earlier files, but you will also understand how to work with HDFS also. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to do an ls on user Ubuntu folder. Ubuntu folder, and you'll see that there is already a couple of databases and files there. Okay, I'm going to remove that. First and foremost, I'm going to say HDFS DFS RM. I'm going to say R. And I'm going to say that I want to remove the folder. Whenever I want to remove the folder, you have to. So the DOAB underscore database is something that I tested already. Okay, this is the database, is actually a folder. So I will show you how to create it again, but I want to delete it. Since I was testing it in the new cluster, I had to remove it. But I am using this opportunity to show you how to actually use RM command in Hadoop also. Okay, and I'm going to use DFS RM R, and you see that it deleted the database. Okay, and this is actually going to create a challenge in once I start the Spark environment also. Let us see that, because I should have dropped the database inside there, but I deleted it here. So let us see what will happen. So all these things, when you are actually working on real world environment, right, doing such mistakes are crucial. That is why I'm actually showing it to you as I am, you know, doing it live. Okay, so now I have removed everything. The older files, everything has been removed. So now I am going to do, I am going to actually push the local customers.csv file back into the environment. Okay. So what I'm going to do is HDFS DFS. I am going to put the customers.csv into users and Ubuntu. This is the folder. In this folder is inside the cluster, so I'm going to put it there. Okay, so HDFS DFS hyphen put will, okay, now it says that no such file or directory. Okay, why? Because the directory name is wrong, so I have to say user, it's not users. Okay, so now it will actually place the file there. This is the, you know, importance of typing, right? So once you make these typing mistakes, you will understand, okay, so this is a small mistake. So sometimes you will actually be surprised that why everything is correct, why the error is coming. As you get deeper into this technology, right, you will start getting used to these kinds of errors. And here we see that the customers.csv has been copied, and you see that it gives all the data related to that. Now, what we are going to do is, we are going to start the Spark environment. Okay, to start the Spark environment, let us go to the presentation again. And inside the presentation, we saw that we can start the Spark environment from the command line using this command. So let us copy this. Okay, let us copy this. Let us come back to the terminal and let us paste this here. Okay, hold on. So let us paste this here. I am not going to give the database name, okay, but I am going to leave REST as it is. Okay, so yeah, one more important thing, whatever command that we are providing here should be in small letter, so we cannot actually copy paste it. So mind that, or else it will create a lot of challenges. So what I am going to do is, I am going to remove all these things. We cannot use it. Good that I remembered, or else it would have created a problem. So Spark SQL. And if I use this backslash, I can use type it in multiple lines. So master yarn backslash. So there should be a space between backslash and the command. And I'm going to say conf spark dot ui dot port is equal to 0, and conf spark dot just a minute, let us check the, Spark SQL warehouse.dir. Okay, let us go back. Spark SQL dot warehouse dot dir is equal to, what we are going to do is, we are going to say user Ubuntu warehouse. Okay, this is what we are going to give, and we are going to press enter. So just give me a moment. I have started the execution right now, and in a moment it will actually come up, and you'll see that it will give the Spark hyphen SQL prompt. We see that the Spark hyphen SQL prompt has been received. So let us say show databases, and let us execute this. So you'll see that I have default DB, and I have BOOB database also, and I have Spark database also. But we had already deleted this database. You remember that, right? But in Spark, still it is there. Okay. So what happens is that Spark environment actually creates a metastore, has a metastore connection with the Postgres database. So it actually gets linked there. So we have to drop the database here, then only the actual database will get dropped. The metadata will still exist inside the Spark environment. So let us start by dropping the database. Drop database BYOB database. Okay, so you see that immediately I am getting the error because the file does not exist, because I deleted the file, right? And in case if I had deleted the file there, and if I started working on it here, so it is, see, it is forced to delete it. So what is happening? Understanding these things are also important. So you saw that now it has got removed right now. So same way, I had actually removed SparkDB. I am not sure whether I removed SparkDB. So anyway, now it is not required, so let us not worry about that. Let us actually create database BYOB underscore database. I'm going to create the same database again. Okay. Now, this error, you don't need to worry about it. Okay. This is, anyway, the activity has been completed. This is happening because of the internal environmental issue. Don't worry about that right now. Okay, now I want to show you something. So I am going to get out of the Spark environment, and I am going to see how the HDFS environment looks. So I am going to say HDFS DFS LS, and I am going to say user Ubuntu. This is where we gave the Spark warehouse, right? So let us see how is it. And you see that there is a new folder called as warehouse. And if you actually do an ls on warehouse, then you will see that the BYOB database.db has been created. So these are all just folders. So databases, tables, are everything are folders actually. They are not something totally different. So not some different kind of file format that you cannot see or anything. These are all simple folders. Inside the database folder, you have various tables. That is how the entire cluster gets created. Okay. You cannot directly edit these files because it is spread across multiple nodes. This is just a database folder, but it doesn't mean that okay, you can actually work on those files directly. So don't mistake the complexity underneath it. The complexity is still there. Only thing is, I'm just showing you what is available. This is the starting point. Okay, if in case if you don't give the warehouse directory, what will happen is, by default, the warehouse will, Spark warehouse will automatically get created without your interference. It will get created in the local file system itself. So you saw the SparkDB database that is inside this. So let me show you. So if I actually let us do a simple ls. So if I do Spark warehouse ls, you will see that inside that there is SparkDB database, the same database that we saw inside the Spark environment, Spark SQL environment. So now, by this time you must have actually got a hold of what exactly the database level of interaction happens. So how is the database created inside the HDFS DFS file system, and how we can work with it, how to actually start the Spark SQL environment. We actually have seen all these things, and also how to work with the data set, how to clean it and push it inside the Hadoop system. We have all seen this. So start working on this level till now. Okay, I want to keep the videos to a manageable level so that you can also take breaks and learn faster. Practice these steps, and I hope that you like this content. Do leave a like and subscribe to my channel so that further video updates you will get immediately as I upload the videos. So with this, guys, practice again. That is the most important thing. Practice again. See you guys.